Hello, I'm Dana Cadman, and today we're going to be talking about design grids. This is part of the Communication Basics series. Another term for a design grid is a layout grid, and why I want to talk to you about them is because, like the series says, this is one of the basics of communications. Grids are important in designing anything, whether we're talking about a website or a Sunday bulletin or any other kind of communications material. Because grids help the eye more easily focus on one element and help it move from one element to the next. If you think about this, if you have a page, whether that is a web page or a printed page or a poster, if everything on there, the text and pictures and whatever, is just all over the place, the brain has to spend extra time sorting out what the elements are first before it can identify what to do with those elements. So if you do not use a design grid in your design, then the brain has to spend more time sorting the information and can spend less time actually focused on the content of the communication. So grids not only make for a good design, they help actually communicate information because it allows the brain to focus on the content rather than sorting out the elements of the content. And that gives the brain sort of kind of an ah effect that if your subconscious mind doesn't have to spend this time sorting out all the elements, then there's less agitation or irritation in your subconscious, and it allows you to the reader to more enjoy whatever it is that you presented to them. Grids also make it easy to design, because when you have a grid of where things are supposed to go, well, that's exactly it. That with a grid, you know where things are supposed to go. When you don't work with a grid, when you just start with a blank page and decide to put things anywhere, you have to make a decision about everything you put on this page where it's supposed to go. So a design sort of gives you a template to work from, or guidelines in where to place information. And then I just want to say this up front, and I'll probably repeat it throughout, is that it's okay to go off grid if you have a good reason for it. I'm not saying that you should do this capriciously or even often. But if there's a really good reason to go off of your grid design or your template, then go ahead and do it if it makes sense. We don't have to be so rigid in our organization that everything has to go to a grid, but there has to be a good reason to go off that grid. Now, this is just a sample of what a design grid looks like. So you can see it's not that complicated. Now, this could be anything, a Sunday bulletin, a web page, a newsletter, any kind of material. And even without pictures or text to tell us what is on this page, you already have a sense of what's going on here. At the top, there's probably a banner or title. In the lower right-hand corner, there's a gray box that could be a picture or a table of contents. And the two larger black boxes could be pulled-out sections of text or photos. And the blue items are probably columns of text. So, like I said, you can see the layout grid already gives you a concept of what it is that you're working with. Now, I'm going to talk about newsletters for just a minute here, that regardless of how you lay things out in your newsletter, there's certain things that you need to make sure you have in your newsletter. We have a nameplate, sometimes that's called the banner. It usually appears at the top, sometimes down the left-hand side. That's the title of the publication, and then below that or next to it is the masthead, which includes your publication date, the volume number, who's publishing it, that sort of thing. Headlines and subheads are obvious, larger pieces of text in a different typeface, color, bolding that help separate one article from another. There's the copy, that consumes or occupies the primary area of the content of the page. You've got graphics and photos that help support the story, and then if there's any advertising you include. Just some good principles in designing newsletter. Make sure you have a table of contents. Now, if your newsletter is only 4 pages, maybe you don't need the table of contents, but if the articles are short, so you've got 2 articles per page, then I would go ahead and include a table of contents, because the table of contents appears on the front page and it helps someone determine whether or not to pick up the publication and read it. That's why you see so many magazines, instead of just a cover art, they've got little blurbs of text that tell you what are some of the major stories inside that magazine. So a table of contents is a great idea. You want to use headlines to draw in readers. You want to make them large, visible, maybe a different color. But most important, you want to make sure that you get a verb and a noun in the headline. that you've got something to talk about and some action to go with it to help give a reader a sense of what the article is about. And continuing to specifically look at the front page, those headlines have to be given special attention to help draw the reader further into the publication. And if you look at any metropolitan newspaper, you'll find that there's several headlines on the front page. Now, typically, one story could occupy the entire front page, but if the reader isn't interested in that one story, they're not likely to pick up that publication. And that's why the stories are usually split into smaller pieces, so you can get three, sometimes maybe four headlines on the front page, with the idea that maybe one of those headlines will appeal to your reader and make them pick it up and start reading that article. And as they flip through the pages to find the rest of the story, they'll find other headlines that are of interest. You could make the assumption that because people come to your church, they want to read your church newsletter, and they probably do, but they might want to give that newsletter to a friend, or you might be leaving your newsletter somewhere else, or you know, maybe you want to get people who are involved in one group aware of what's going on with, you know, what's going else in other going on in other parts of the church. So it's just a good idea to put as many headlines as possible on the front page without making the front page be cluttered, because if you put too many headlines, nothing stands out. So it's a balancing act. A general rule of thumb is use at least one graphic per page. That can be a picture, a chart, some kind of graph, you know, anything. It doesn't have to be large. Again, it depends on the story whether it requires a large picture or not. But the rule of thumb is the more detail, the larger the picture that needs to be. If you've got a picture of just one person's face, that picture can be fairly small, maybe the width of one column. But if you've got a graph that shows trend lines, and there's maybe three or four trend lines with data points on them, that picture is going to have to be fairly large for people to be able to read it and understand what's on that graphic. And you know, that's the whole reason, you know, we want to create an easy to read design. That's the purpose of doing a design grid. And this applies more to content, but we want to write to express, not impress. We're trying to express thoughts and ideas here, and that should come through in our design. We're not trying to win a design contest. If you do, that's a great side benefit. But if your goal in designing your newsletter or redesigning it is to win a contest, then you've lost the focus of engaging your reader. Now here's some layout grid examples. We had that generic one up first, but here's just two samples. It's got some faked up text here, so you can get an idea of where the columns are and how much text you can put in there. It shows you, you've got your banner across the top, your nameplate's below that. Now in one, the nameplate is on the left. The masthead is spread out underneath the name of the publication, where on the right-hand side, the masthead is all justified to the left, all grouped together in a little block, and that's underneath the title. And I'm not saying one's better or worse, I'm just saying that these are a couple options you have. As you can see, both publications have a table of contents. They just happen to put it in the lower left-hand corner. You can put it wherever you want. But again, this just gives you an idea of a mock-up, what a publication could look like with a layout grid. And just a couple other examples, too, to show you again. You know, these are still four-column layouts, even though the left column is being used for table of contents and other information. The stories are in the center and right columns. You can split this up any way you want, but again, just more examples to show you how a layout grid, your eye is immediately drawn to certain things, and it's easy to move from one element to another, which is the whole purpose of the layout grid. Now, I want to switch from newsletters to Sunday bulletin just a little bit. The same rules, everything we just talked about applies to a Sunday bulletin in terms of a layout grid and using columns. I want to spend a little bit of time talking about how you divide up the pages of your Sunday bulletin. A lot of churches I go to use a bifold because it's very simple to do. The problem with a bifold, and if you look at the top here, the right panel, the front page occupies 25% of your bulletin. So that means that there's basically only 75% of your bulletin that you can use to convey information. Now with the front of your bulletin, certainly you can do, you can include contact information, the name of the series if you want, and other stuff, but usually the cover doesn't change, and so from week to week that space essentially ends up wasted. As an alternative, what I would like to suggest is going to a trifold brochure. These are more difficult to fold, but what it means now is that even when you allow for the extra gutter space, which is the space between the text on different pages, only 17% of your bulletin is used for the front cover instead of 25%. And 8% doesn't sound like a lot, but with a trifold, it's amazing how much more information you can get into your bulletin just by going to a trifold instead of a bifold. Of course, it means that any inserts you include must also be smaller. And sometimes that's a good thing because, again, oftentimes I see at church inserts where they've obviously made things larger or included some frilly graphics or whatever just to fill up the space when they didn't really have very much to communicate, which isn't to say it's not important. It just didn't have a lot of text or information that needed to be conveyed, and the bulletin or the insert could have been smaller. So I'm just saying this is an advantage, is that instead of maybe printing two inserts on a page, now you can print three inserts on a page and save yourself some printing costs. I talked a little bit about this, but in your cover, you've got two options. You can have a static cover or a dynamic cover. A static one, again, this is where nothing on the cover changes from week to week. You've got your email addresses, office phone number, your church's website, maybe Facebook address. You've got the church's logo or a picture of the church or something going on in the church. Where a dynamic cover, on the other hand, now this requires more work as you're changing it, but something about the cover is different. Now, I wouldn't change the information on the cover, but if you're going to change the cover, you should change it for reasons. Either change of season is typical, or change it for different series. If you are a church that does sermons in series, like maybe 4 or 6 part series, or if you're doing a book study that might run 12 or 16 weeks, you have a particular piece of artwork that you use to identify that particular series. And that's great if you're going to do that, but somehow the image should support the Sunday message, not just tie the bulletins together for that period of time, but in some way help people think about the series, think about the topics in the series, think about the actions they're supposed to take as a result of listening to the sermons, something like that. But even though you're changing the image from week to week for this series, or maybe changing it for this series, like I said, whether it's 4, 6, 12 weeks, make sure that there are some common elements. If the design changes every week, you're, again, forcing people to think about why is the cover changing and what is it I'm supposed to do with it. So instead of changing it just for the sake of change, make sure that you have some common elements to help tie these different images together. And that could be, for instance, you could have a larger picture. And if you're doing a four-part series, the cover of your Sunday bulletin each week could be 1/4 of that larger image. So when you put the four bulletins together, they form the larger picture. Or potentially it could be the same image but with a different color. Or something I saw that was really cleverly done is the image was black and white. I'm sorry, I don't remember the topic, but it was a black and white image, you know, with gray, kind of a pencil sketch. And it was mostly grayed out except for that part of the design that was being emphasized that Sunday was, rather than washed out, it was, more, a higher contrast and brightness, so it stood out. Kind of like if you remember the old Highlights magazine, trying to find the hidden objects, you know, by coloring them in. Now, everything we've talked about so far has been about print, but all of these same principles apply to websites. Even though the medium has changed and the page tends to be wider rather than narrow, like paper, you still can use a grid. You can still do columns. You still need a nameplate or title for your page. You still need to know where things go, and having a layout grid helps you place things when you're creating new pages. Just something to be aware of, though, in a website, you're going to want to have different kinds of layout grids, and you don't need a lot. At minimum, you need a layout grid for your home page, because your home page is the entryway to your website. You want that to be a little bit different because it's going to have different kinds of information. Most of the pages in your website are going to be informational, so they're going to be text or text and pictures, so you'll want a grid for that. And then another grid that's highly useful is to have one for lists. Listing events coming up in your church, listing contact people, you know, different ministry leaders and staff and such like that. You may have some others, but these are the three most common types of layout grids that you'll want for your different website pages. And here you can see this is a layout grid for a web page. It looks somewhat similar to the one we saw for newsletters. Across the top there, you've got your title. Down the left-hand side, this is probably where you're putting your site navigation. Across the bottom is a footer with your church's address and phone number. And then we've got, you know, some headlines and text here. So see, even again, without knowing what's on this page, you very quickly get a sense of what this page is about. This is a more edgy design for a church. It's just an option. These two big gray squares could be blocks of text, or one could be a picture, the other one could be text. The boxes, the black ones down at the bottom, these could be your Twitter, Facebook feed. Your navigation, instead of down the side, is across the top in that black bar. Again, your title, your banner for your church is at the very top of the page. So just to show you that you've got some options here in terms of how you lay things out. And it is, I would like to say, whether you're doing a newsletter, a Sunday bulletin, a poster, a web page, whatever, it is a lot easier to come up with this grid and rearrange this first before going into detailed conceptual designs that need to be rearranged. Because you can create these designs, if you've got a whiteboard or even just a piece of paper and a pencil, you can sketch a dozen of these in 10 minutes or less. And in such, rather than having someone who has some artistic skill maybe spend a half hour or an hour coming up with a conceptual design, just to have everybody pick it apart and move things around. So this is a much better way to honor people's time, and it's also, I think, a very quick way to hone in on ideas you want to keep and to throw out ideas that you don't want to work with. Visual focus. We talked about using headlines and pictures to draw attention, and I want to reemphasize that here, that this works depending, it doesn't matter what your publication is, printed or electronic. Headlines and pictures help draw attention, help get people focused on the content so that they can actually start reading it and find out what the article's about. Visual cues, just to let you know that graphics, you can use shape, you can use size, you can use color or even contrast if you're doing black and white. These are all things that can help draw attention to the graphics that you put in there, or help outline or draw attention to text. And make sure you use white space to separate elements and reduce the grayness of the page. And all that means is that if you were to take a piece of paper with text on it and have someone hold it 10 feet away, you won't be able to read that page unless you've got very good vision. But you'll very quickly, you get kind of a grayness to the page because the text all blurs together. If you have a lot of text, which is, you know, text dense, the page will appear more gray, where if you have less text, the text is more spaced out, not only between the lines of text, but between the columns, the text is larger, the page will appear lighter. You don't want a page that's too light because it becomes too difficult to find the information on the page. You don't want too much text on the page because it becomes very text heavy and becomes more of a burden for the reader to read through. If you look at a paperback book, a lot of science has been done to determine that 200 to 250 words per page is about what people will process before experiencing mental fatigue. So just something that you want to keep in mind is you want to stay right around that 200 to 250 word mark if you're going to put a lot of text on a page. Graphics, photos should support the story, not tell the story. That's not to say that photos can't be very impactful, very evoking emotive response and such. Certainly through the years there have been some amazing photographs that you immediately connect with, but they don't tell the story. They engage you, they draw you into it, they make you want to find out what's going on in the photo, but they don't tell the story. So make sure that your photos support the story, which is also to say that just because you have three pictures to go with an article doesn't mean you have to include all three pictures. If the pictures are redundant, or if the picture, well, this is cute, but it doesn't really talk about what's going on in the story, only one or maybe two sentences even reference what's going on in that photo, toss out the photo. It's got to support the story. Clip art. I've seen there should be a fine for using clip art inappropriately. I like clip art. I use it quite often in some of my presentations. But again, I see clip art used to fill space. I use clip art used in an unprofessional manner. I see it used inconsistently, where you've got a very nicely drawn, artistic picture of something, and then two columns over, you've got this cartoonish image that's going on. And unless you're doing a comparison contrast, those different styles of art should be separated by at least a page, if not separated into different publications, because you want to have a certain tone to your articles as well. And the graphics will help set the tone for the article. Branding, I'm mentioning this only in that if you're redesigning your website, you're redesigning your newsletter, whatever, make sure that all of your communication elements tie together somehow, which is not to say they have to look identical, but try to borrow common color palettes. That doesn't mean you have to use all the same colors, but just make sure that you're using, you know, a subset of some larger palette that you've defined. Try to use similar colors, use the same typeface, unless there's a good reason not to. Your Sunday bulletin, your website, your newsletter, your business cards, your stationery, all should be using essentially the same kind of typeface. Especially in headlines, body copy, you can get away with something a little different if you need to. Make sure that if you're going to put the logo of your church in the upper left-hand corner of the webpage, it goes in the upper left-hand corner of your stationery, in the upper left-hand corner of your newsletter, just so people get used to looking for things in the same place. So anyway, that's what I wanted to say about design grids. I hope this information was helpful and that you can start looking at all of your communications and reviewing it and begin seeing where you maybe need to better solidify your grid or maybe start over with a new grid. Again, once you start using grids, I think you'll find that they're a very useful tool and make design decisions much simpler. We're discussing this on EPC Community, which you can find at epc.socialgo.com. If you've got a question, a comment, if you've got resources you want to share, please leave them there. And the slides of this presentation will be uploaded to the EPC website, and you can find that under Ministries in the Christian Education and Communication section. Thanks so much for listening, and I look forward to your questions and comments on EPC Community.